Nobody has to save the planet. The planet will be perfectly fine. It might take a couple of million years to recover. So really what we are trying to do is keep the planet in a shape that we can survive in. And yes, it's natural that that's our top priority, but we should also be aware of the fact that that is really what we're doing here.
We don't have the Adriatic, we don't have the Aegean, we don't have the Mediterranean Sea, we don't have the Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, or the Indian Ocean. It's all one ocean.
Things are changing. Climate is changing, temperatures are changing, currents are changing, the weather is changing. And they have been changing for a long time, but never at the rate that things are changing right now. While it's only natural that all the species migrate with the temperature shift, it does bring a lot of issues with it. So we talked about the lionfish already, so that is just one. But also, even if you would say everything goes north by however many degrees and everything stays fine, right? Certain things just can't move. Seagrass meadows that we find around here might have been around for a couple of thousand years to grow to that size. So if they should have to move north, it will take them hundreds to thousands of years to be up in that size again. Also, especially in the Mediterranean, we have a couple of dead ends. So if a fish has to swim north and north and north in the Adriatic, at some point it's going to sit in Monfalcone and that's it. So that's when they disappear. And that's the things that we're facing right now. So we are losing species on a daily basis. We have new ones coming in, or ones that just shifted the location. So it's really, yeah, a thin line to say that should happen and that shouldn't happen. But things should not change this quick. So I see it as perfectly normal that things do shift. That's fine. Like a seagrass meadow can grow bigger, can get smaller a little bit, can get denser or thin out and migrate altogether. And when I say migrate, I mean expand on one side and shrink on the other side. But the speed at which things are happening right now is incredible. Like within 5-6 years, you could see seagrass disappear in Pula altogether. And it took hundreds of years for it to grow there. So that shouldn't happen this quick. Coral reefs are dying around the world, and it took them thousands of years to grow to the size that they were when they started dying, but it only takes 1 year to knock them down. And that's a very scary development, because we are on the brink of losing incredible habitats, and once they're gone, they won't come back. We will have the privilege to see a lot of things that our kids probably won't see anymore. And that's just something we should, for one, cherish, but also be aware of, and ideally do our very best to make sure our kids can see it, or our grandkids. But that again is something that very few people manage to think about, like two generations down. Well, ultimately everything is linked somehow to the climate. And you can find documentaries from, I think, 40, 50 years ago even, of people warning about climate change and saying we have to do something in the next 20 years or it's going to be too late. Every year we have a climate conference where people say this year we have to come up with solutions or it's going to be too late. Personally, I think it is too late. Like the ship has sailed. We cannot save everything anymore. Everything we can do now is damage control. So yes, lots of important habitats will go down the drain. We will lose a lot of biodiversity. That's already a done deal. But what we can still do is do everything we can possibly think of and try every little tiny string that we have somewhere and hope that something works.
Thank you.
Earth is the wrong name for our planet. It should be called sea or ocean. We are all connected through that, as how much of a cliche it actually sounds. But one ocean is something that people really, really need to know. We only have one ocean, and we are on this planet because of that ocean. Most of our foods come from the ocean.
So the thing is, the oceans have tons of issues that they're struggling with at the moment. And as I said before, the Mediterranean is, in a beautiful way, the most impacted one in many of the cases. So when the whole world is talking about keeping climate change down less than 2 degrees, the Mediterranean is already 3 degrees warmer than it used to be. I mean, climate change is something that few people still deny. It is happening, and it means all the populations, all the locals, they have to adapt to that. Either they adapt or they will be pushed out of the corner. So in the Mediterranean now we have a massive influx of tropical fish species that come in from the Red Sea. And obviously if something comes in that hasn't been there before, it kind of kicks somebody else out of that niche, especially if they can reproduce a lot faster. So that is one of the biggies. Another one is pollution in many ways. Doesn't matter if you talk about plastics or if you talk about oil or just accidents at sea or oil platforms that tend to leak a little bit, sometimes more, sometimes less. But everything that shouldn't be in the environment is sort of an issue. Plastic has only been around since sometime in the Second World War, and already you can go diving wherever you want and you will see plastic. It just doesn't matter where you go. In the case of the Mediterranean, also tourism and shipping industry really kicks in. It is, for one, a massive amount of noise pollution. So that's mainly important for all the marine mammals. So dolphins, whales, all those are massively affected. But everywhere where there's boats, there's usually anchors. So those are one of the biggies for the seagrass, because every anchor is basically like a plow. So if you drop it in seagrass and you try to dig it in and it doesn't grip, you will rip out seagrass, and it might take as much as 20, 30 years to close that gap again. Fishing, always a favorite. So we catch a lot more fish than can reproduce, especially if they lose their breeding grounds. And on a global scale, we already caught more than half the fish that is on this planet. And looking at the numbers, we are slowly running out of fish. I mean, there's these beautiful predictions where they say in 2050, there will be more plastic than fish in the ocean, which is really not that difficult, because other predictions say that by 2050, we will catch the last fish. That being said, in places like the Pacific Plastic Gyre, you already have more plastic than plankton. And plankton is supposedly the biggest biomass on this planet, meaning if you collect all the plankton, like tiny plants, tiny animals that are just free floating and can't move against the current. So if you throw all those on one pile, that's going to be bigger than if you chop down all the forests and throw them on one pile. So that's the amount of biomass we're talking about. And yet, in some parts of the world's oceans, we have more plastic than plankton. That's quite a scary thought. And while many people are still talking about the five gyres, as in where the ocean currents just make a spiral and that's where the plastic is collecting, in many papers by now, the Mediterranean is considered the gyre number six, because the plastic pollution is just so high around here. And that will eventually come back and bite us in our own butt, because plastic as such is mostly visually not so pleasing, but then it disintegrates with sun, UV, radiation, and the salt. It's just a killer combination for everything. Everybody who owns a boat will know that. And eventually it breaks down into microplastics, nanoplastics that then come back into the food chain. And the plastic we produce is usually not just straightforward plastic. It has softeners in it, it has colors in it, it has all sorts of weird stuff in it that is attracted to the plastic, kind of like a magnet. So you have lots of toxic stuff that accumulates around these plastic particles that then come back into a food chain. Just like everything in a food chain, it accumulates the higher up you go, and the fish we eat is usually somewhere high up in the chain. So basically we are eating all the toxins that we throw back in the sea.
Every action that we are doing in our daily life affects that one big ocean that then affects all of us.
Obviously, the objective is to find solutions for the existing problems. So right now, Posidonia is one of the main issues that we are working on, simply because it's vanishing in many parts of the Mediterranean. So it needs attention. It is a very important breeding ground. It's an incredible habitat for many marine creatures to live in. And if we lose that, a lot of things will follow. And that starts with fisheries. It starts with the biodiversity underwater. So a lot is at stake. And just because seagrass vanishes, nobody complains yet. But it will come.